that surface, and that then you touch your hand to your face. That's the common way of spreading. But now there are some, you know, studies which are saying that it has also got an aerosol spray that, you know, it can say stay in the air and linger in the air, and it could pass from one person to the other. So guidelines are now coming. I think in the US they made it mandatory. They made it, I think, compulsory in Mumbai, in Delhi, that everybody should wear a mask. A surgical mask is good enough. You don't need to wear the N95 mask. And even a good cloth mask that you can reuse at home is good enough, because the healthcare workers or the people at the front line will need the surgical mask. Today, the surgical mask cost has gone up 15-fold.
Wow. Okay, doctor, another quick question which I got, which is like a layman question, is that India typically is a hot weather climate. And there is a belief that in hot weather, the virus will not thrive. To an extent, people are saying stand in the sun between 11 and 12 and you'll get the immunity levels high. So what is your call with the temperature related to the virus?
No, it's a postulate. It's not been proven. There are still studies. So I don't think we should, you know, it's a myth. We should not, you know, believe in that. Sitting in the sun is not going to do anything for sure.
Okay. Doctor, a lot of people on this forum are basically exporters of apparel and textiles. They run huge factories and they have a lot of concentration of labor and workers at one place. So if a particular person gets infected in your factory, I presume the chances of others getting infected are very high. So what is your call on that? Should they be quarantined in such a way, or what is the suggestion?
So the first is that if a person gets who is known to be positive, he or she needs to be isolated completely. So if they are symptomatic, they are put into special BMC isolation wards. If they're asymptomatic, they can even be home quarantined. And for the contacts that are in the contact of that person, again, twofold. If they are asymptomatic, they can be home quarantined. If they are symptomatic, then they should be tested. And if they are asymptomatic and they need to be tested, again, wait for at least 5 days before you do the test. So yeah, isolation, home quarantine is the norm at this point of time.
Okay, another question which just came in on WhatsApp was, what's the precaution one should take while consuming vegetables and fruit that you buy from outside? Any specific precautions, according to you, we should take?
So I think, good hand hygiene is the important thing here, because it's known that this virus does not transmit through food. As long as you are maintaining good hygiene, you are washing the fruits and vegetables, you are cooking them well, and your hand hygiene is important. You know, you are taking care to sanitize, your doorknobs or the other things where your hands will touch. The important thing is hand hygiene out here. I think I can't stress upon more than that. So hand hygiene becomes the important aspect.
Okay.
That it's not going to get transmitted through food. But.
Okay. Doctor, another question is that if a person has already had the virus and he's got cured, then what are the chances? Can he again get it? Or then he gets, his body has already built in the immune system?
Right. A fantastic question, Amit. Typically you would expect that once the virus has been in the body and the immune system is good enough, you would develop two types of antibodies. There is an IgM type of antibody and an IgG type of antibody. The IgM antibody is a short-lived, it comes up and it goes away after some time. But the IgG antibody is what remains for a longer period of time. And traditionally, it is proven that IgG antibodies, as long as they remain at a particular level, will offer immunity to the virus. Now, what remains is that viruses are particles that change their structure, what is known as mutation. The fact that we have not been able to develop a vaccine against, say, the HIV virus is because that virus changes its shape very fast. Even the flu vaccine that we get, we have to change the constitution of the vaccine because the virus keeps changing its structure. So we don't know for sure how the COVID will behave. It's still very early and we're trying to see that, you know, is there any mutation that will happen or not. But the common scientific belief or the medical belief is if you get IgG antibodies, it should offer you protection.
Okay. Doctor, the next question which just came in was that if a person does not show any symptoms, but he has a regular cough and he feels that he may be, you know, developing COVID virus, you know, can he just come and get it tested?
So whatever studies that have come from internationally, and I have some medical friends who have shared their experience over the last 1 month. They say fever is a very important symptom for anybody to be suspected of coronavirus infection. Absence of fever to a large extent takes away this fear of the infection. However, I mean, you know, it's not 100%. So if you feel that there is a chronic symptom which is, you know, continuing, like a cough, dry cough particularly, or shortness of breath, please see your physician, and the physician can, you know, prescribe, because we need a doctor's prescription, you know, to do a test today. ICMR wants us to fill in the doctor's details. So we can't just have a walk-in patient without a doctor's prescription.
So a regular GP of ours who's, you know, an MD, he can prescribe and you will test the person?
MBBS and above, absolutely.
Okay, going back a little bit on the food article which I was asking you, you know, cooked food I understand is safe because it goes through the heating process and everything. What about raw food like salad and, you know, fruits and all that? How safe are those?
So I think as long as they are getting washed well, you see what happens when you're eating it, it's going into your stomach, and the acid in the stomach generally kills everything. So okay. I don't think consumption of food should be a challenge. As long as it is washed well, it is hygienic, and your hand hygiene is good.
Okay. And what about, you know, the blood donors who come to your clinics, you know, for donating blood, or you have the blood donation drive and all that. Don't you think those people should be first tested before taking blood, or is it already happening? What's your call on that?
So as per current guidelines internationally, it is not seen that the coronavirus can be spread through blood transfusions. So currently there is no screening done for this in blood donation. However, you know, the general precautions that somebody who's got a respiratory infection, or somebody who's been recently hospitalized, somebody who's got fever. So there are anyways general criteria that who can give blood and who cannot give blood. But specifically, there is no need to test for this in blood donation.
Doctor, the other theory, especially, you know, in terms of the Indians, is that by nature, our immune system is better because we eat a lot of spicy food and other things. And the most important thing which people are saying is that because we've taken the BCG injections when we were young, so there are good chances that we may not get this disease. What is your call on this?
So there are two theories out here, Amit. One is, if you look at the global map on where coronavirus is maximum and where it is less, mm-hmm. it is inversely the map where malaria is very high and where malaria is very less. So mm-hmm. all those countries where malaria is seen to be endemic somehow seem to have a better herd immunity against coronavirus. Wherever okay. we find malaria to be less, we are finding that the immunity to this is less. So one is the malaria postulate. And second is, of course, there are studies on the BCG vaccination that it offers some protection. But the BCG vaccination is taken in a larger, a geography as well. So, you know, we are still trying to ascertain if it is true. But it could be that both BCG and the presence of malaria being endemic could offer some protection to the Indians.
So maybe that's like kind of one of the reasons, like you see the positive rate in terms of the testing, you know, around 3.5% or 4% in India, because maybe some of those things, you know, combined together are helping us in some way.
Yes, absolutely. And I think also the fact that you know, the government has taken bold steps in, you know, making sure this lockdown is happening and people are understanding this, I think that has also helped.
No, I think that one of the best things that could have happened for India was the, you know, bold decision our government took at a very early stage. We didn't wait for it to start peaking, you know. At the very infancy stage, we put in the lockdown, and maybe it may be increased by a few days because people are saying we have still not peaked. We may peak in the next 2 weeks' time, you know. So, and knowing the Indian mentality, because there is no medicine, there is no vaccine, the only cure was to quarantine yourself, you know. So, I think from that point of view, government is doing a fantastic job, and you guys on the front, on the other foot soldiers. And I really want to once again appreciate the hard work you guys are doing. You know?
Thank you.
Doctor, the other theory, especially if you look at the Italian context, is that why is it that the senior citizens are the ones who are most affected, and the fatality rate is also the highest in the senior citizens? But on the flip side, in India, it's not like that. You know, on the Indian country, we are still seeing 20 to 35 or 20 to 40 range getting more affected. What could be the reason for this, you know?
Right. So See, the fatality comes from, I'll just use a medical term, it's called cytokine storm. So cytokines are, you know, the defense mechanism of the body. And in coronavirus, the defense mechanism actually goes out of whack. It goes completely out of control. And it's the overriding of these cytokines that actually causes the lung, you know, a problem to have. The pneumonia that happens in the lung or the interstitial disease that happens in the lung. Now, in the elderly, you generally expect that your immune system is a little on the weaker side. And that is why internationally you are finding that, you know, people who have an underlying condition like diabetes, you know, heart disease, any other underlying condition, cancer, chemotherapy, where the immune system is already compromised, those are the people who, you know, tend to succumb to this more. In Indians, you know, you mentioned that we eat spicy food, but spicy food is not the reason for actually getting immunity. Immunity is built based on, you know, good healthy diet, good rest, you know, adequate sleep, exercise, you know, eating the right kind of food. So that's the kind of thing that builds immunity. So there are still a large segment of society in India that don't get these, you know, enough. So we have across the segments, different categories of people where the immune system could be weak.
Okay.
And that is why we are seeing a different approach in India.
Okay. Doctor, just your opinion, you know, people have been talking about, you know, countries being in stage one, stage two, stage three, stage four. Typically, where do you think India is? Have we entered stage three or what do you think where we are just now?
So I don't want to create any panic or fear, but I would say over the last 1 week, we started seeing certain, you know, hotspots in the city of Mumbai, at least, because that's what I can comment on. Mm-hmm. The, you know, like Dharavi, for example, is mm-hmm. one area. We are seeing certain pockets in Worli, you know, certain pockets in Borivali. So there are these, you know, hotspots that are developing. I don't think we've gone into a full-fledged stage three, but we have started seeing these, you know, hotspots. And again, I would really applaud the BMC. You know, we've been working very, very closely with the BMC, and the municipal commissioner is doing a fantastic job. I think they've brought in that containment of these hotspots really well.
Yes.
And they're taking our help to get testing done for those containment areas.
Yeah, I think that, you know, at the center, the central government, and not only Maharashtra, but all the state government, the coordination that we are seeing this time, yes, for this common enemy is fantastic, I think. You know, there is no politics here. It's totally a focused battle that we are fighting. And I'm sure, yes, that India is going to come out with flying colors. Doctor, one more question. People say that there is a test that you can do at home. Now, they say you hold your breath for 60 seconds. And if you're able to hold it on, means more or less you are okay. You know, you don't have any infection or anything. What do you think, that's something we should be doing, or we should be coming to you for that?
Actually, I've not even heard about this. This is the first time I'm hearing this. So please don't do all these things. You know, go by what is proven, what is, you know, documented. You know, please don't try these home remedies, please.
Another thing, doctor, what about contamination in terms of, you know, newspaper and all? Because people have like suddenly got worried. I don't want to have a newspaper. You know, people say, I'm going to iron my newspaper before I open it. What's your call?
No. So it's a logical fear, because, you know, the vendor who's delivering the newspaper, if he's coughing onto the newspaper, we know that the virus can remain active for a few hours to a few days on inert substances. So whether it is, you know, paper and cardboard, of course, is just a few hours. But if it is, you know, stainless steel, or if it is plastic, it can last even for a couple of days. That's why it's important that you clean your doorknobs, you know. So, yeah, I mean, go digital, guys. I mean, you know, I think we can actually do away with so many things. We've realized during these days that how we can still continue to live effectively and productively despite, you know, the restrictions that have been posed upon us. So, you know, we don't need to go out and eat. We can still, you know, cook food at home. We can learn to cook food. We can learn to read. You know,
yeah, we all have become master chefs. All the guys have become master chefs.
And of course, I think we have all become experts in housekeeping also, I think. You know,
so. Yeah. What about drinking hot tea like 3-4 times a day and all that, and taking steam? Is that something which is helpful for the virus, or just a myth?
It's just psychologically, it makes you feel better. So please go ahead and drink hot green tea, but not for the virus as such.
And doctor, one more thing, that if a person has been tested in a laboratory like yours, which is a private laboratory, do the government recognize those tests? I presume, of course, they do, or they will say, no, you still get admitted and we want to again test it in a government hospital.
No. So on 22nd of March, the government actually reached out to us. They said that we don't have the bandwidth to test the number of people that are there in this country. So they chose labs that have the PCR facility and who have what we call as NABL accreditation. That accreditation qualifies you to have a certain quality standard. So they have reached out to only those labs who they believe can add value. And our data is now being directly fed into the local BMC authorities as well as to ICMR centrally. And it is this data that is being used to collate and, you know, take informed decisions. So our data is, you know, considered completely genuine. There is no need to repeat the test.
Okay, great. We are in the last 5 minutes of the segment, doctor.
Sure.
What I wanted to ask you was that the drive-through testing, which you are saying you're going to be launching, what is the amount of capacity you anticipate, like per day, how many tests you all will be able to do? And it'll be the mouth swab, I presume.
Yeah. So we have one mobile van that we have created and it is parked at Andheri Sports Complex, where people can just, you know, stand and go into the van, sit inside, get the swab done, and 10 minutes you are out. We do about 50 collections in the van every day out there. We don't know how the drive-through will be. We have given, we are operational from 10 to 6, and we have given 10 appointments per hour. So we are hoping that we should be able to serve around 80 patients a day. This is completely digital. You have to log on to our website, fill in the form, you will get a token. And you just drive through with that. There is no interface with anybody. You show that token, your swab is taken, and you drive out. So, you know, we're trying to make it as seamless, as convenient as possible. We'll know from Monday how, you know, but we hope that we should be able to serve between 50 and 80 patients a day.
Okay, doctor. Just a few closing remarks from your side and what you suggest that, you know, what all of us should be doing to stay safe and what is the thing that precautions we can take at home, if you can give us some advice. I'm not going to get into any of the controversial so-called questions about, you know, free testing and all that, because I know that it's the matter is still in the court and things like that. But I want your advice specifically on what can be done, a general message to all the public, because we have a lot of exporters, you know, who could be representing close to 5 to 10,000 people here. So if you could give a message to everybody, it will be great.
So I think these are unprecedented times. We've seen, you know, these kind of pandemics happen once in a generation or maybe once in two generations. This is something which we will all remember, and it's important that we make sure that this remains a positive memory for us. So, you know, home quarantine, I cannot emphasize enough about that. There are lots of, speculation that this will get extended. So make sure that you find ways to keep yourselves engaged at home. Eat well, sleep well, exercise, download apps like CureFit, which is they take these exercise sessions. There are enough, enough and more opportunities to keep yourself healthy at home, keep yourself engaged. I think technology is a great tool. We've seen overwhelming support from the public, like you said, for the healthcare workers at this point of time. That is what has actually kept us motivated and excited. There's also been some sort of a negative aspect that, people are ostracizing somebody who's become positive or ostracizing the healthcare worker. Please don't do that, guys. I mean, it's for nobody's fault that he or she has become positive. I think as long as we are able to keep that distancing, it's not that the virus is going to jump from them to you. It's not going to happen like that. As long as distancing is maintained, don't ostracize people in these times. Support each other, encourage each other. I've seen so much of, outpouring of support and emotion. Everybody has come forward and said, okay, doctor, please tell us how we can help you across every channel. So we are all so emotionally charged at this point of time, and we are indebted to all the support that we are getting. Our team is completely charged up. Getting our team to travel is a huge challenge today. So So we have to arrange for transport, you know, to make sure that they come. We are arranging for special accommodation for them to stay near our lab. But we are getting a lot of support. You know, everybody is coming forward. So just stay positive is what my message to everybody is, that, you know, this is a storm, you know, where, you know, eventually, you know, the storm will run out of its water. It will go down the drain and we will still come back alive. Yeah. We'll come back safe and we'll come back stronger. I think Indian population is a lot more resilient in it than anybody else globally. And that's the message that I would like to leave, you know, that stay healthy, stay strong, stay safe.
Yeah, Doctor, I, on behalf of my Confederation of Indian Apparel Exporters, I want to thank you immensely, because to you, Dr. Arora, to your organization, to Suburban Diagnostics, who's doing a fantastic job, you are the real COVID warriors. We need you in the forefront. From us as general public, if you need any help, support, we are always there, because this is a battle that we have to win. And I once again thank you. For all my friends who don't know Doctor so well, I can tell you he's a doctor with funny bones. When we meet him on a lighter note, we have to hear his jokes. He can tell you one of the most funny and most, you know, bone-breaking jokes, you know. So, Doctor, next time over a drink, we have to continue with those jokes of yours. Thank you so much.
Look forward to that. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.